Oh. someone very close to kin to you or next to kin, and if a person is sold themselves into slavery or has become captive because of death may be over, then the closest kinsman, called the kinsman redeemer, can pay that debt or to buy their kin out of slavery. And they are called kinsman redeemer. Another history about a redeemer is, say if someone is murdered in the Old Testament. Now in the Old Testament, the next of kin or the closest kin can seek justice for the one who was murdered. Now you can get vengeance if you was next of kin, say your brother or sister or someone close kin to you had been murdered, then you, in the Old Testament, can go and get vengeance. In other words, pay back for the murder. And that person who seeks that justice for the next of kin is also called the kinsman redeemer. Now, with that in view, the Lord Jesus Christ is our kinsman redeemer in the New Testament. God came in the flesh, He came one of us, and died on the cross for us, so that we can be saved, so that we can be forgiven of our sins. So He became one of us, our kinsman redeemer, and not only that, the murderer, the one, our enemy, the one who comes to kill, steal, and destroy, Satan, our enemy. Also, our enemy is death. Also, our enemy is sin. So those enemies, the Lord Jesus Christ has sought vengeance. He conquered death. He has conquered the devil, Satan. So He is our kinsman redeemer all the way around. So we who are redeemed and have been purchased by His blood, it says, let the redeemed of the Lord say so, whom He has redeemed from the hand of the enemy, death, sin, and the enemy, our adversary, the devil. Verse 3. And gathered out of the lands, from the east and from the west, from the north and from the south. So He has gathered all of us, the redeemed. You know, in the book of Revelation, it describes eternity and when we serve the Lord and we walk with the Lord. But in Revelation, it says every tongue, in other words, glossolalia, every language, known language, and every tribe and every nation is going to sing praise to the Lamb of God. So whatever race you are, you're going to be that race in heaven. Whatever tongue you speak, you're going to speak it in praise to the Lamb of God. Did you know that? So those from the south, from the north, east, and the west, everyone that has placed their faith in the Lord Jesus Christ and called Lord Yahweh, your Redeemer, we're going to give Him praise together. Isn't that a wonderful view? So if you can't get along with each other here, what are you going to do in heaven, brothers and sisters in Christ? What will you do there? But let us say, you see, this song is a testimony of us, the redeemed. It is our witness to the world. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Now we get into the wonderful stuff, what the Lord has redeemed us from. And it begins in verse 4. Verse 4, it begins that the redeemed who were lost in the wilderness. And there are so many lost in a desert wilderness today. Maybe they wandered in the wilderness in a desolate way. They found no city to dwell in. So wandering around, lost in a wilderness. And I have been lost in the woods before as a young boy. And it's a scary feeling. And yet, there are millions wandering around today without a Redeemer. But maybe you were there at one time. Maybe verse 5, hungry and thirsty. There's so many hungry and thirsting and trying to seek that satisfaction from what the world has to offer, what the enemy has to offer. And there is no satisfaction without Jesus. Amen. He is the person that completes us. He is the person that can only satisfy us. Hungry and thirsty, they're so fainted in men. Have you been there in life that you are just at faint? You're at the end, and yet, verse 6, if you write in your Bible, circle verse 6, and we're going to circle other verses just like it. Notice, then they cried out to the Lord in their trouble. Now, if you fall asleep here in a few minutes, get this. Listen to me. You can cry out to the Lord right now. You can call upon His name and notice what He did. Then they cried out to the Lord in their trouble, and He delivered them out of their distresses. He saved them from wandering around in a desolate desert wilderness. And He saved them. He delivered them. He is the Redeemer. And the redeemed that has been redeemed out of that desolate desert wilderness, let you say, hallelujah. He has delivered me from that trouble and delivered them out of their distresses, and He led them forth by the right way, and that they might go to a city for a dwelling place. Psalm 107 is also a song about God's Word. He directs our path. He leads us by this right here, by the guidance of the Holy Spirit and by His written Word. Amen. So He led them forward by the right way to a dwelling place. Verse 8. And by the way, this is an exclamation point verse. Matter of fact, say it with me, church. Say verse 8 with me. Oh, that men would give thanks to the Lord for His goodness and for His wonderful works to the children of men. Verse 9, for He satisfies the longing soul. No longer thirsty, no more hungry, no more wandering around. He satisfies the longing soul and fills the hungry soul with goodness. Redeemed. Lost in the wilderness, but the Lord is redeemed. Number 2, the second fruit that had been redeemed, the redeemed who were prisoners in a deep, dark dungeon. Let's read verse 10. Those who sat in darkness and in the shadow of death. And by the way, if you have not been lit up by the gospel light, you're in darkness right now. You're sitting in deep darkness right now without Christ, if you do not know Him. Listen, bound in affliction and irons, and there's people today bound by addiction, bound by all sorts of things that this world has to offer, and they're bound in affliction and irons and just cannot break them themselves. Chained up, and chains that you may have some material possessions and all of that, but you will come to the realization that life is not all right if you despise his word. Bound. Why? Because they despise these words. Therefore, verse 12, he brought down their heart with labor. They fell down, and there was none to help. If you're bound in darkness this morning, if you're bound by addictions or drugs or whatever your addictions may have you bound today, no one can help you but the God of this book can. The God of this book can. It can break those chains. Verse 13, this is one to circle. Verse 13, then they cried out to the Lord in their trouble, and he saved them out of their distresses. He brought them out of the darkness and the shadow of death. And he can break those chains. He broke their chains in pieces. Say verse 15 with me, sir. Oh, that men would give thanks to the Lord for his goodness and for his wonderful works to the children of men. The Lord is good. He's good. Verse 16, for he has broken the gates of bronze and cut the bars of iron in two. You see, he can deliver you out of any prison that you're in right now. He can do it. He's the Redeemer. Verse 17. These are those who are redeemed who are living with bad choices. But the Lord can redeem. Amen. I'm an example lay of someone who can make bad choices, but I promise you, the Lord can redeem you. The Lord can fix any bad choice you've made. Sometimes you got to live with it, but I promise you, it's going to help you to it. He's the Redeemer. For those who have been redeemed and living with bad choices, even to the point of death, verse 17, fool. Now the definition of a fool in Scripture is someone who even dares to say there's no God. That's a fool, according to God. So fools, because of their transgression and because of their iniquities, were afflicted. Their soul abhorred all manner of food, and they drew near to the gates of death. They would not eat of the manna from heaven. They refused, and because of bad choices, to the gates of death, near the gates of hell. Verse 19, circle this. Then they cried out to the Lord in their trouble, and he saved them out of their distresses. He sent his word and healed them and delivered them from their destructions. So the redeemed who cried out, even with foolish choices in life and living with them, cried out, God delivered them. Say, verse 21 with me, church. Oh, that men would give thanks to the Lord for his goodness and for his wonderful works to the children of men. Let them sacrifice the sacrifices of thanksgiving and declare his words with rejoicing. Now in the New Testament, our sacrifice, first and foremost, is the Lamb of God. faith choose that we receive the blood of the Lamb, but now we as the church, the fellowship, the koinonia, the blood bought, we are living sacrifices unto Him. That's the sacrifices that we give, and we do not do it begrudgingly, but with rejoicing. With rejoicing. There's a last group that, you know, we're all part of some group that has been redeemed. This last group, the redeemed, who experience storms of life, we all experience, even, you know, saved or unsaved, there are storms in life. And our Redeemer sees us through these storms, and He can save from the storms of life. Verse 23. Those who go down to the sea in ships, who do business on great waters, they see the works of the Lord and His wonders in the deep, for He commands and raises the stormy wind, which lifts up the waves of the sea. They mount up to the heavens, they go down again to the depths. Their soul melts because of trouble. They reel to and fro and stagger like a drunken man and are at their wit's end. Just like in the great ocean or on the Lord's lake and the wind comes up and they're just tossed to and fro. People who are living in life without Jesus, when this storm comes and storms in life come, that's all they have. They just reel to and fro. Maybe this will help me. Maybe that will help me. And we're told here there is no help. There is no help, even though they're in prison or in bondage or lost their way. None can help but one. And yet in these storms in life, it says they're at their wit's end. All hope is gone. And sometimes people got to come to a place in life where they got to realize, man, I'm at my wit's end. I cannot help myself. No one else can save me. I cannot redeem myself. No one else can redeem me on this earth. But the Lord Jesus Christ can forgive me of my sin. You see, to really be saved, biblically, we're called to repent. We're called to agree with God that I am a sinner and I have no hope without Jesus. That is called confession and repentance. That is coming to your wit's end. So, coming to the wit's end, and they do what? Verse 28, certainly. Then they cry out to the Lord, again, the personal name of God in the Old Testament, Yahweh, the covenant God. He's a personal God that will come to you in the storm. They cry out to the Lord in their trouble, and He brings them out of their distresses. He calms the storm so that its waves are still. Then they are glad because they are quiet. So He guides them to their desired heaven. Again, how does He guide us? With the Holy, His Holy Spirit and with this. He guides them. He guides them to their desired haven. Say verse 31 with me. Oh, that men would give thanks to the Lord for His goodness and for His wonderful works to the children of men. Let them exalt Him also in the assembly of the people and praise Him in the company of the elders. Is that where your heart is? experience this redemption. Experience daily the redeemed. You don't know what this is about. You don't know the true meaning of being grateful and the rejoicing and exalting Him in the midst of the assembly. Because it's not personal to you. You may know a few details about it. You may know some of this right here. But unless He has broken those chains, brought you from the very gates of hell, from death, to spiritual life, you don't know what it's about. Matter of fact, verse 43, I believe, is the key verse of the whole song. Look in verse 43 with me. Whoever is wise will observe these things, and they will understand the loving kindness of the Lord. Whoever is wise, you see, the Bible plainly states in the New Testament, with all the Old Testament proverbs and the wisdom literature we have in the Old Testament, and even the oldest wisdom literature, the book of Job, says, I know my Redeemer lives. And in my flesh, though, I am buried in worms, eat my flesh, yet in my flesh I will see Him. The oldest wisdom literature in the Old Testament says that. So in light of all the Old Testament prophecies of the sacrifices that speaks of the redemption in Christ, of all the Old Testament wisdom literature, in light of that, the New Testament brings it down that the wisdom of God is a person. His name is Jesus Christ. And if you do not know Him, you may think you're intelligent. You may think that you have logic and you can debate this or debate on either side. And you may be very smart that you can do all sorts of things. But without Jesus Christ, you're lost and you're unwise. No matter how wise you may think you are, please listen from my heart. A heart of love. Without Jesus, you're unwise. That's the key verse of this whole song. Whoever is wise will observe these things. You see, the key of it, it's not our faithfulness. Yes, we are living sacrifices. We've got to rely on the Holy Spirit daily. We've got to adorn the armor of God. But the key of it is not our faithfulness, but His. He's the faithful one. Our faith must stand, begin in His faithfulness, rest on His faithfulness, and trust His faithfulness to the end. Whoever is wise will observe these things. We respond in repentance and in faith. Let the redeemed. This song is so rich and full of treasure, but let me end this morning with Romans chapter 10. What is the verse that, that I would read and before y'all would help me read? Then they did what? They cried out to the Lord. And what did the Lord do? He would deliver them. Romans chapter 10. Romans chapter 13. Romans chapter 13, beginning. No, it's Romans 10. Romans 10. Y'all still with me?
Yes.
Okay. All right. I gave y'all something last night. That's good. Romans chapter 10, verse 9. Again, they cried. Now, please grasp the meaning of the word cry. I mean, it's not just a tears can be part of it, laughter can be part of it, but this is from the heart to cry out to Yahweh. It means your whole being is crying out to Him. Verse 9, that if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and do what? And believe where? In your heart. In your heart that God has raised Him from the dead, you will be saved. He will deliver you. He will redeem you. For with the heart one believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. For the Scripture says, whoever believes on Him will not be put to shame. For there is no distinction between Jew and Greek, for the same Lord over all is rich to all who call upon Him. We cry out to Jesus. For whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. The Word of God promises us that in repentance and faith in Him, you cry out to Him, He will save you. Will you do that this morning? Will you cry out? Will you choose the Lord Jesus Christ for salvation, our kinsman, redeemer? I'm fixing to pray. Now we're prepared for the invitation this morning. I will pray, but as soon as I'm quit praying, come on up here. You come to Jesus. I'll help you in any way, but you come and call upon the name of the Lord. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we thank you for your precious word, and we thank you for the promises of redemption by your word. And Lord, help us to be wise unto salvation at this very moment. Lord, be wise unto what the Scriptures teach us about trusting in you this morning. And Lord God, may you be glorified in this invitation. And may you be glorified in the church this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Please stand.